extra hour at the end. And there's going to be a barbecue also around 6:30, so that will be an extra incentive for hanging around, even though we're having a longer day than usual. So that's all I have to say. And so I'm going to introduce the first speaker today, Maru Sanewe, who is going to continue on her lecture yesterday and present the high school from the Uniform Boundaries.
Juste une question, tu sais pas où il y a d'autres crêpes parce qu'elles sont toutes petites.
D'accord, mais comment ça s'agit?
Ok, so, good morning. I wrote some references on the blackboard. They are not complete. So, I will give you a paper with the complete references maybe next week. I can recall that yesterday, I gave a theorem. Of Maeser and Kamini, which says that if the morphism from the dissymmetric power of x0p to the winding quotient is a formal immersion at infinity d, then y1 of p of k is empty for all k of degree d over q. So the goal of my talk of today is to show that we have a formal immersion for p great enough in the case d equal 1 and in the case d greater than 1. So this case will finish the proof of Maeser theorem. Which was the subject of the talk of Henri Darman. So it was the only point that he didn't explain. And I will explain it today. So we are now looking for a criterion of formal immersion. And maybe I will first recall what is a formal immersion. So. So I recall that phi, a morphism between two Noetherian schemes, is a formal immersion at a point x in x if the induced map on the completion of the local rings at y, so here y is the image of x, so the induced map should be a surjection. Equivalently, there is another description. So this is the differential criterion. Phi is a formal immersion at x if the induced map on the residual field is an isomorphism and the induced map on the cotangent bundle is a surjection. So in our situation, this condition is always verified. So the point is to find a criterion to have a surjection from the cotangent of GE to the cotangent at infinity d of x0p to the power d. To do that, we have to understand both parts of this morphism. And first, we can notice that so you have to admit that we have a morphism, such a sequence, from cotangent GE to cotangent G0P. So over C, it's almost obvious. But the thing that is not obvious is that it's also true over Z. Okay, so Z here is Z 1 over P. And that's a non-trivial fact that this injection extends to an injection of the contingent space over Z. Okay, so it is due to Mazur plus plus Reynolds result. And for instance, if you replace Z by the ring of integers, it's not true. And there is a morphism with this cotangent space to the space of the modular forms with coefficient in Z. And also here, it's non-trivial that the obvious morphism isomorphism over C extend to an isomorphism over Z. Okay, this is due to so this is implied by the so-called Rotundic duality, which is over C the Serre duality. So I can add the name of Serre. And then, if you take a modular form here, you can take its Q expansion. It has been explained by Darmon. So you arrive in the formal series over Z. And here, we have an injection. So this is the injection is due to the Q expansion principle. And it's a key fact that we have an injection here. But now we want to understand the morphism from cotangent E to cotangent infinity D x0pd. So we have to understand this bundle. And if you look at, maybe I have to say that this morphism is, in fact, related to the phi star, where phi is a morphism to from x0p to j0p. Because you see here, you have the differential over x0. Again, here you have the evaluation at 0 of the differential on j0. So it's really the phi star map. And so let's now look at this space. You have Q, a formal local parameter of x0p at infinity. It has been explained by Darmon. This means that the completion of the local ring at infinity is isomorphic to the Q. So if you take the d power of x0p, you obtain d formal local parameter, q1, qd. And now if you go to the quotient by the action of the symmetric group, you obtain that formal local parameter are given by the symmetric function in q1, qd. So here, these are the symmetric function. So sigma 1 is equal to q1 plus qd, etc. Sigma d is equal to the product. So this means that the cotangent space of x0pd over infinity d is a free z module. So this is over z. Is a free z module of rank d. And a basis is given by d sigma 1 d sigma d. Comment? D'accord. Merci. Mais là, il y en a plein. So now I claim that you have the following lemma. Okay, I have not the ability of Damon. So I claim that if you take W, a differential on J0P over Z, such that the image in the modular form has Q expansion of the form AMQM DQ over Q for M greater than 1, then the image of this by the map phi d star is equal to phi d is equal to a1 d sigma 1 minus a2 d sigma 2 plus etc minus 1 to the power d minus 1 d sigma d. So the proof is easy. You, if you take, so you have.
Is that a d?
Sorry?
Is it a sub d instead of d at the end?
Well?
The last term, the last a d in it. Is it a sub d?
Oh, yes.
Oh, and d.
So if you take the map from the d power of XRP to the quotient by the symmetric group, so let's call it P. Then if you take the pullback of this by this map, it can easily be described as the sum y equal 1 to d of sum for m greater than 1 of am qym dq over q. Because this is just a copy, d copy of x0p. I did a mistake?
DQY,
yes. So it's equal to sum for m greater than 1 of am m minus 1 dsm, where sm is equal to the sum of qi to the power m. Okay, and now it's an exercise to see that the Newton formulas, which relate sm to sigma m, implies the fact that m minus 1 dsm is equal to minus 1 to the power m d sigma m. Can I? You will see that we have immediately. We can finish the proof of Mayer's theorem. Because if you take W in a cotangent J E qu'est-ce que je veux dire? Sorry, I am a little tired. Okay, yes. So let's take such a differential such that the image here is an eigenform. Okay. Then, by the Q expansion principle, its Q expansion is not identically zero. So, since the value is an eigenform, we have A1W is non-zero. Because otherwise, all the other coefficients would be also zero. Okay? Otherwise, AMW is equal to zero too. So, A1W generates the cotangent space, which is the module of rank 1, and W is the image of, A1W is the image of phi d of E of W star, so it's finished. Is this okay? So it's the end of the talk of Darmon. And we also deduce from the can I erase it, Henri? And you also deduce from the lemma the following criterion of formal immersion. Theorem. So maybe it's in the case d greater than 1, it's due to Kamiani, which says that the following are equivalent. First, phi ed is a formal immersion at infinity d. Secondly, there exists f1, fd, be modular forms with coefficient in z, which are killed by the. So this means that yefy are equal to zero. Okay, ye is an ideal of the Hecker algebra. Maybe I can recall it. So this is the Hecker algebra, which acts over the space of modular forms and leaves stable the subspace of modular forms with coefficient in Z. And so you ask that IE FY is equal to zero. Okay? So there exists such form such that A1 FY AD FY. So these are vectors in Z. And you ask that those vectors are actually Z linearly independent. So you see that this implies the surjectivity because of the diagram here. Okay? So this is equivalent by the lemma. But now we have a more comfortable version of this, these things. You ask that the image of the first D Ecker operator, T1, Td, in the quotient of T by the winding ideal, are the linearly independent. So this is in fact, actually the dual version of two. So this is a dual point of view of two. Indeed, Darmon explained that there is an isomorphism between S2P Q and the dual of the Hecker algebra, given by sending F in the map which associates to T the first coefficient of TF. And actually, this is isomorphism is also true over Z. Okay, so you can see that S2PZ is the dual of T. And the duality here gives the three the equivalence of 1 with 3. And we will give yet another formulation of the three equivalent condition. Because recall that the winding element E is an element of the absolute homology. So from now we will we'll denote by X the set of rational points of F0P. So it's Riemann surfaces, which is isomorphic to the quotient of the Poincaré of plane with the cusps by gamma 0p. And you have an element here, which is almost equal to minus 0 infinity. But not exactly. I will say something about that later. But the Hecker algebra, which is a subring of the endomorphism of J0P, acts also on the first group of homology. Okay? So you can look at the module generated by E, and it's a T mod YE module free of rank 1. So it gives immediately that 1, 2, 3 are also equivalent to the fourth condition, for that T1E, TDE are the linearly independent in TE. And The heart of the Merrill's proof was exactly to prove this condition for p greater than something. Okay, and I will explain now how we did to show that.
Sorry, what is TE?
TE here? Yeah, it's a T module generated by the element E in the endomorphism of the group homology.
Okay, what was E?
E is a widening element. Darmon defined this. Maybe I can. I will recall what it is just now. Okay. So. So now I will explain the heart of the Merrill proof. So okay, I briefly recall what is E. So maybe I will not define it exactly like Darmon did. I don't remember. But there is an isomorphism of C of R vector space between the homology with coefficients in R and the dual of the differential with coefficient in C. Taking a path here and mapping it on the integration over this path. Okay? And if you look at the linear form, which to W maps the integration of W over 0 infinity, and you take the pullback of it, then you find E, by definition. Okay? So I think Darmon says that it was related to the integration of over 0 to infinity. I don't remember very well. So you want to say that it's almost minus 0 infinity. When I say 0 to infinity, it means infinity. Because, okay. So if I do a draw, you take this path and you take it, you map it in the quotient, and you obtain this. Okay. So you want to say that it's only the path from 0 to infinity, but this doesn't live in the absolute homology group. This lives in the relative homology group to the cusps. Okay, so there is some difference between those two elements. I don't want to explain very well. There is a difference between E and 0 infinity. And this difference is the Eisenstein part. It's due to the Eisenstein part of the relative homology. Okay, it's the part on which TR say or TN acts by multiplying by sigma prime N where sigma prime n is by definition the sum of the divisor of n, which are prime to p. Okay? So to avoid this problem of difference between e and 0 infinity, instead of looking at e, t1, t2e, etc., we will modify slightly the Ecke operators. So recall that we want to prove that for p greater than something, for p greater than t3d squared, e t2e, so this is equal to t1e, t2e, etc., tde, are linearly independent. And instead of it, it suffices to prove that e small t1e, small t2e, small td e are the linearly independent where small tr is equal to tr minus sigma prime r. So you see that here the effect is to kill the Eisenstein part. So it's great because tr e is exactly equal to tr 0 infinity. And for us, it's easier. Okay? So now we will prove it. So I want now to explain the proof without explain all the details. The minus sigma prime r, and it's the sum. It's explained here. It's the sum of the divisor of n, which are coprime to r, to p. Excuse me. So now, what is the idea of the proof? So you can forget all the first part of my talk. Now we just want to show that those classes of homology are independent. So we now work in the homology group, and we forget all the modular forms and etc. Okay. So the idea of the proof is the following. The key point is that we have an intersection, a pairing over the homology group, which is called the intersection product, which I will denote by a bullet, from H1 XZ cross X1 XZ in Z. And which maps, roughly speaking, if you have a path and another path, you want to count the intersection between them with a sign. So, for instance, if you do a C cross C prime, you obtain a plus here and a minus here. Okay? So. Anyway, so now that we have this intersection product, suppose that we have a linear combination which is 0, lambda 1 e plus lambda 2 t2 e plus etc., lambda d t d e equals 0. Then the strategy is to find suppose that we have such a combination for C lower than D. Okay, so we will do by killing one after the other the coefficient here by the right from the right side. Okay. So the strategy is then find XC in the homology group such that TCE intersected with XC is non-zero, but all the others are zero. Okay, for strictly lower than C. So you see that this will imply that lambda C is equal to zero. Okay? So we will do that. So to do that, there are two key facts. I don't know if I will have enough time to develop all. But there are two key facts. The first one is that we have a presentation of the homology group by generators which I call CK and relations. And the second fact is that we know how to compute the intersection between two such generators. So, we will only need to express the TRE in terms of those generators, in terms of the CK. Okay. So first, I will develop the first and the second point. Maybe I will admit those formulas for this, and I will conclude the proof. So first, Manin symbols. So let's alpha and beta be two elements of P1Q. So you can take alpha and beta here. Here it's the Poincaré of plane. And you can take a geodesic from alpha to beta. Okay? So take a geodesic pass. And then you go in the quotient, and then you take the homology class. And I will denote this element by alpha beta. Okay? So you obtain someone, alpha beta, in the relative homology group. And it's an exercise to see that such element can be expressed as a sum of a class of the following type: B over D, A over C, where ADBC are in Z such that AD minus BC is equal to 1. So this is not difficult. For this, you can use continuous fraction. No. Not at all, because we are in the relative homology for the moment. Okay? No. You take a geodesic in H, and a geodesic in H for the hyperbolic geometry is an arc of a circle. Sorry? Yes, that's all. And so what was saying Hugo is that if you are indeed, if you have that gamma 0 p alpha is equal to gamma 0 p beta, then when you see it in the quotient, you obtain a closed path. So then, the alpha beta will live in the absolute homology. The second point of the exercise is to see that actually, the class defined by alpha and beta, by BD, so B over D, A over C, depends only on the class of the matrix ABCD modulo gamma 0 P. Okay? So if you do this exercise, we obtain a map which is surjective from the Z-free group generated by the quotient of SL2Z by gamma 0 P in the relative homology. And this map just take a class of an element G which is equal to ABCD to B over D, A over C, which is equal to G0, G infinity. So the first point of the exercise shows that this map is surjective, and the second that it's defined. The point is that we have an isomorphism between the quotient of SL2Z by gamma 0 P and P1FP. Just taking ABCD and mapping it on CD. So we will denote by C over D simply C ABCD. So there are two such type of elements. If you suppose that nor C nor D are zero, then you obtain a xk for k in FP star. It's equal. So it's an exercise to see that. So you have to find the good matrix. It's equal to 0, 1 over k. And since those two elements are conjugated by gamma 0 p, you obtain someone which is in the absolute part, in the absolute homology group. And it remains so. And such elements will be generators of the absolute homology groups. Okay, can I go up? So those elements are generators. And it remains xi zero and xi infinity, which are opposite. And which are equal to zero infinity. And now, if you take only the generators of the absolute homology group, the xik, there is a lemma, which gives the intersection between those xik. It's the lemma des cordes of Merrell. So let's take two elements of 1 p minus 1. And for such k, denote by k star the element of 1 p minus 1 such that k star times k is congruent to minus 1 mod p. Okay, and now look at the unit circle and place on it the following units, E 2YP K over P, E 2YP K star over P, which I will denote maybe sometimes by K and by K star. And take the chord, the oriented chord between them, from k star to k. So ck is the chord. I don't know how to say chord in English. Okay. So the chord from e to ep k star over p to e to ep k over p in the unit circle. Do the same for ck star. So maybe here you have a k prime and a k prime star, and you take the chord here. Then, same for k star, k prime. Then, the intersection product between k xk and xk prime is equal to the number of intersections between ck prime and ck. So this is the number of intersection. So it's equal to minus 1, 0, or 1. And for instance, so the point is that you take the unit circle oriented. And for instance, in this on this draw, so you take ck prime, ck, and since you have to go in the oriented sense, here the number of intersection is plus 1. So it's a funny lemma, I think. And now I will explain how to use this lemma to conclude the proof. But before, I have to give you two formulas which you will admit as a black box. It's not so difficult to prove, but it's a tedious calculus. So, that's not correct. Alors, c'est 2, 2, 2. So, the first The first formula will express TRE as a sum of Manin symbols. So here, W and T are the lower coefficients of a matrix, which is in a set, XR, is equal to the set of matrices M with coefficient in Z, such that the determinant is R, and U is greater than V, greater than 0, W is lower than T, greater than 0 strictly. Okay? So maybe I just give the idea of the proof. The idea is since we killed the Eisenstein part, we have that TRE is equal to minus TR 0 infinity. And then the formula is almost, I am not sure here, but it's almost the sum of B over D infinity with D being R and lower than D minus 1 and greater than 1. And then you use a continuous fraction method, almost, to have the formula. The second formula is that you can directly express P minus 1 E intersected with xi k. And there is a formula involving Dedekind sum. So here, those are the Dedekind sum. I will not recall what are, but the point is that it only depends on the class of K modulo P. Yes? Oh, sorry, I didn't understand. I am not sure that I. You mean that if they cross like this? No. If they cross like this or like this, what's your problem? It's always true. This lemma. I mean, for instance, if they are like this, it's 1. If they are like this, it's 0. But. Could you speak low?
Instead of the straight line between the points, if we get the geodesics between them, the intersection number will change?
No.
No?
I don't think so. But so they are not, it will not change.
So the left one just says that the intersection number is not changed if we go to the quotient.
There is no rapport between the Poincaré plane and the unit circle here. Unit circle. There is no rapport. It's just a computation. The proof of this lemma is not really interesting. It's just that you take each case and you see that it's equal and that's all. So maybe I can, because it remains a few minutes. If you are agree, I will take maybe a few minutes more to end the proof, because it's funny. The end of the proof is really pretty. So. So now we have all the ingredients to prove the theorem. So the end of the proof is like this. So we will treat the case of lambda 1 apart because of the Eisenstein part of E. So suppose that we have such a linear combination. And we will first prove that lambda 1 is 0. It's a slightly different than for the other coefficients. So the point is that we will look for a class of homology in the form of a generator such that E intersected with K, with CK, is not zero, and for all the others, you find zero for all or greater than one. Okay? So let's look at the second condition. The second condition, by the first formula here, means that you have for UVWT. In XR, that the sum here is zero. So, and actually, we will look for someone, such a generator, such that for all W over T, we have zero. It's stronger, but it's sufficient. For all UVWT in XR. And so let's look how those things will be distributed on the unit circle. So let L in 1 P minus 1 congruent to W over T mod P. So L star will be congruent to minus T over W mod P. And I claim that L and L star are greater than P minus 1 over D. This is an exercise, not difficult. And then if you look, if you place it if you place it on the circle, so you take the circle. Okay, that's not a circle, but imagine that it's a circle. So here you have zero, which is equal to P minus one. Here you have for instance, P minus one over D. And all the W over T and the minus T over W, D is the degree of the number field.
Oh, okay.
All the L like that live in this part. Okay? So the chords are all like this. So it suffices to find a K such that Ks are in this part. Because then it will not cross all the chords which live here. Okay, so the point is that it suffices, so for instance, like this, it suffices to find K in such as in this arc, which I will call C, for instance, K in C, such that K star is in C. Also, so it will imply that TRE CK will be zero by the lemme des cordes. But we want also that E intersected with CK is non-zero. Okay, this is the first condition. I don't know where, here. Okay? And it's not difficult now to see that it is possible by an analytic lemma, which I don't want to give, for p greater than d3d2. So after, once you had this idea, it's only a calculus to find such a k. Okay? And I just want to finish explaining for the other coefficients. That's almost the same idea. So for lambda c, c greater than 1. So now we have such a linear combination. So suppose that we have this equal to 0 for c lower than d and greater than 1, strictly. Then we want xik such that tre xik is 0 for all or strictly lower than c, and tce xik is non-zero. So the point is that it's a little more complicated because we don't know exactly how that this appears only in the sum giving TCE and not TRE for R lower than T. So we will look for XK such that C1 over C XK is non-zero and all the others are zero. And now I just do the draw corresponding to this question. So we look for xk such that x over 1 over c xk is non-zero, and xwt xk is 0 for all uvwt in xr for all or strictly no exist. Okay? And w over t different from 1 over c. So you have 1 over c here. Maybe, so it's actually equal to p minus c star in 1 p minus 1. And you have here 1 over c star, which is p minus c. You have the chord here. And you will look at the xi L for L equal to W over T. And it's an exercise to see that so you want to look the difference between L and 1 over C. Okay, so let's call it Q, maybe. You want to look at the difference. And it's an exercise to see that the difference is greater than a delta, which is equal to p minus d2. Yes, p minus d2 over d times d minus 1. So you have here a delta. Okay, and all the other L lives in this part of the circle. So that's the same thing as before. You want, but now you want a k here, such that k star is here, because you want to cross this line. Okay? So let's call it A and B. So it suffices now to find k in A such that k star is in B. Because then you will have that the chord will cross this chord, so it will give this, but the other will not cross it. So it will give the other part here. Okay, that's the idea. And the same thing, this is possible by the same analytic lemma as before. When P is great enough, and that's the end of my talk.